Welcome to Shadow Jam, ushering in a new frontier in film. My name is Doug, and today we're going to be looking at the Yashica Electro 35. We're also very lucky to be joined by Japanese camera expert Domo. The Yashica Electro 35 is a camera unlike any other. A fantastic 35mm rangefinder that took the late 60s and 70s by storm. This particular one is a third generation GS model, but there are Gs, GLs, GXs, GLTs, GSNs, and even GTNs. Did the person who came up with this naming convention spend a number of years on the Toyota assembly lines? Well, let's look at the evidence. Nagano Prefecture, where Yashica's HQ was, and Aichi Prefecture, where Toyotas are made, are next door. A coincidence, or perhaps something more sinister. Now let's go back to the late 60s, and the biggest thing in cameras was automatic metering, in particular automatic shutter control. All the things that we take for granted in this bland digital age. What this does is it not only makes taking photos easier, but it opens up photography to people that were put off by the complexity. It makes it appealing to the mass market. In my book, this is only a good thing, because it's only when we challenge the status quo do we truly begin to innovate. Why on earth should taking photos be difficult? It was marketed as having an intelligent brain that meant all you had to do was focus, frame, and shoot. Its f1.7 lens was another selling point, allowing it to even capture photos by candlelight without a flash. Wow! It was a huge success for Yashica and helped to build it into a household name, unfortunately one that is no longer quite with us. 1974 wasn't a good year for Yashica, or Japan for that matter. A Japanese economy in freefall, rapid inflation, huge drop in exports, and rampant trade unions. Financial mismanagement and the embezzling of 1.8 million at Yashica led to large bailout and even fire sale of assets. A factory manager attempted to commit seppuku, blaming himself for the sale. A union leader recovering from exhaustion in hospital actually did. Yashica managed to escape the storm of this turmoil, but would later be sold to Kyocera in 1983, and then the trademark finally was sold off to a Hong Kong company in around 2005, who would plaster it all over a range of cheaply made goods, which is a real sad ending for one of the greatest camera manufacturers of the 20th century. Perhaps if we start a Kickstarter campaign, we can buy it back. But we're not here to talk history. Well, we kind of are. Now let's get back to this fantastic little camera. In terms of looks, well, it's beautifully designed. Some might say a little bit on the chunky side. And I'd agree, it's not really a compact rangefinder. It has a really solid and robust feel to it. The finishing and detail on this camera are simply lovely. It's clear that a lot of love went into it by the designers, and I can't help feel the same. For something that retailed for around $100 at the time, it can now be picked up between $20 to $30 on eBay, which I think is rather affordable. Also, they made millions of these, and they're not quite a cult camera, so you should be able to pick one up reasonably easy. Let's start on this massive and beautiful lens. It's an f1.7 lens at 45mm, which is rather fast and a lovely focal length. The lens, I believe, has 6 elements and 4 groups. On the lens, we have 3 different modes. Automatic mode, which is the aperture priority mode. Flash, whoa, he saved every one of us Gordon mode and bulb mode. Focusing is done on the closest ring to the camera's body, and this is an exercise in relearning. I've used so many lenses where the focus ring is the furthest one away. Curses, all you other camera makers! Which often means I'm grabbing the aperture ring by mistake. The throw isn't bad, probably about 90 degrees motion between each extreme. It has these small little pads which allow you to grip the focus ring between your two pincers. It's so silky smooth. In the middle of the lens, we have the aperture select, which has a small tactile click. Very easy to change the aperture. The lens also has a shutter release timer on it, allowing you to capture those all-important holiday snaps and even selfies if you're strangely that way inclined. Each to their own, I say. Some other features on this camera. On the back, we have the battery test lamp. This is fairly prominently placed on the camera, but considering the camera's shutter is fully automatic, it's fairly important, as there's nothing stopping you taking pictures if the battery was flat. The shutter will still fire without a battery, and this will be at the fastest shutter speed, which in this case would be 500ths of a second. Your mileage might vary depending on your model, and no responsibility will be taken by myself or Domo for under or overexposed images. So what that means is that if you buy a camera where the electronics are completely down the gurgler, then you don't have a complete paperweight. But having said that, this would make a beautiful paperweight. But who in their right mind uses paperweights in this digital day and age? The battery light indicator on these things often doesn't work, which sadly includes my version. But that doesn't mean the rest of the camera isn't working. The camera has a speed of 30 seconds to 500th of a second, which is controlled by the solid state brain. Yes, 30 seconds. And this might explain and fully back up the claim that this can take pictures in any lighting. At 30 seconds, you'll have a picture of something, even if it's a blurry mess. Now that probably surpasses a lot of digital cameras in a lot of respects. Film ISO is determined by the flat looking dial on the top of the camera, which allows the brain to figure out what speed to shoot at. Nice and simple. Now the people that designed the Sony A7 could really have learned a lot from this little camera, like reliability. The fact that the camera still works after all this time just shows you how well it was put together. Taking pictures is simple. Simply wind on, depress the shutter slightly, and the camera will indicate whether the exposure is over or slow. There's these beautiful LED lights on the top of the camera, which are also visible in the viewfinder. An arrow has also been provided to indicate which way to turn the aperture dial. The idea being to keep turning in the indicated direction until the light goes out. Genius! The sound of the shutter firing is rather subtle. It's fairly quiet and it's unlikely to draw too much attention to yourself. But given the camera's sign, if you have a voyeuristic nature, you might want to find a better hiding place. Loading film. Simply open the door, bang in the film, and wind on. Nothing to see here, move on. So how does it shoot? Well, let's take a look at the results and have a look. Final apologies for the poor scan quality. In future episodes, I promise they'll be scanned by a competent or semi-competent professional. I think it takes lovely pictures and did very well. Take my word for it, as from the scans, you would never know. So overall, what did I think? Well, I loved the f1.7 lens at 45mm. It's simply fantastic. Loved the sturdy build quality of it. the small touches and the feel of the camera. The light meter built into it is fantastic, and it's fully working on this thing, which is a first, so I'm happy. Yes, it is a bit bulky, so if you want something compact, then this is not for you. It was a little bit difficult in some light situations to focus. In terms of manual control, then yes, you're limited in not being able to select shutter speed. So overall, it's a fantastic little camera that's really hard not to fall in love with. So if you're looking for a camera that's petite and small enough to fit in your pockets, then this certainly isn't the camera for you. Unless, of course, you're one of those people that makes a living stealing cans of beans from your local supermarket. If you're looking for a fully manual camera, then this isn't the one. You can't select shutter speed. But so what? Sometimes it's nice not being in control. If you're looking for a fantastic rangefinder with an intelligent brain that was made by love by one of the best camera manufacturers that ever existed, then this would be my camera of choice. Thank you, as always, for watching Shutter Jam. This is my sixth installment of the show, which is a learning experience in itself. Apologies for the large break, but my work-life balance was all wrong. Please let me know what works and what doesn't in the comments, or even message me. Thanks to all my 23 subscribers, it means a lot to me. You really rock. There's a lot of great new content and improvements to come, such as properly scanned film, and perhaps even some decent lighting. So please like and subscribe to keep up to date with new content. As always, I look forward to seeing you next time on Shutter Jam.